How you guys and girls doing? Are you ready for some Dakar? What? Good. All right, so I'm going to talk about the quest in a project for really containerizing as much as we could, but you know, still being pragmatic, still trying to use Docker what it was meant to be used in a way that actually delivered additional value to our client. This is based on some real world, real project experience, so I really hope that it inspires you. It'll be opinionated. Some things we did may not work for you, but still, I hope that you understand and you see more how Docker can really, really change how projects ship, package, and run their code. First of all, by myself, I think I can tick all the usual network, social network sites in case you want to get in touch with me. My name is Oscar Lalias. Once again, I'm actually coming from Helsinki, though I don't really look Finnish, that's because I'm Spanish. I've been there now for a while. I've been working at Accenture for 8 years. I'm a senior technology architect. I have the pleasure to work in a global group called the Emerging Technologies Group. What we do in there is we really look at all these latest, newest technologies, not because they're cool, well, a bit, but also because we really think that we can use them to help our clients in their problems, so kind of bringing some of the new stuff to our clients. Specifically, I work with, one of the things I work with is containers and Docker. My story with Docker started in around Docker 0.5. That's actually less than a year and a half ago, although in Docker terms that's like ancient because, you know, in 2 years they hit already version 1.6. So back then, back in Docker 1.5, 0.5, we really saw there was a lot of potential with Docker. We really saw that Docker could really dramatically change the way we deliver applications to clients, internally or whatever. We really saw that it was going to be something big. I'm not really boasting or anything, but that's exactly what we saw. That's exactly what happened now. I mean, if you think about it, Docker by now it has like 2 to 3 million downloads of Docker Engine, hundreds of millions of images pulled from the registry. So it really is something that actually everyone must have worked with Docker. We get questions about Docker every day. You see lots and lots of talks in YouTube and Twitter about Docker, and it really is a big thing. As I mentioned, this is going to be opinionated, so bear with me. I'm happy to then have a chat with you after the talk in case you don't agree. We can also start out with outside, I'm okay. But otherwise, we can do it nice and easy. I mentioned we've done this for a client. It's for a Finnish client. I would say they are old-fashioned and uptight. Just don't tell them, but they are. They really run a very tight IT organization where, you know, ordering a server takes weeks. It takes a number of support requests, tickets, approvals, and so on and so on. So, you know, even though they didn't like it, if I call them old-fashioned, they really are. What we actually proved for these people is that they actually can run new stuff and still, they're very strict about security. We did manage to integrate Docker well into the security practicing guidelines. So, you know, Docker, you know, many of you perhaps have the privilege of working with cloud and, you know, deploy whatever you want and provision your server. Clients like this at Accenture, we have a lot of them, and you know, they always think like, no, Docker is not for me because it's insecure and whatever. It actually is not the case. So we actually made it work for a client where things like security, where things like being very strict about what gets deployed and when was very important, we still made it work for them. All right. This was for a special project, or a specific project where we're actually building a mission-critical application for this client that was going to run the main core business process. I cannot unfortunately tell you what those processes are, but it's enough for you to know that they're actually very important for the client. The application itself is very simple. The client is very happy to go open source. Yay. So essentially, we have Angular on the front end running on Nginx, super cool web server. We have Tomcat, really just serving simple Jersey endpoints for our front end. And then we store things in Postgres and Solar. We have containerized all of these things except Postgres. And I'm going to get back to that later. When I mentioned we containerized everything, I really meant it. We not only have we containerized the application, we've also containerized all that we call the application, the architecture services. So we run things like Rundeck for automation, we run things like YAM, the rule of YAM and RPM, so we have YAM as a container, we have reverse proxies of the place as containers, we run the Docker registry as a container. I would say about 95% of all the things we run on those servers are containers nowadays. But why? It's cool, right? And everyone wants to do it. I'm actually also one of the global responsibles of Accenture for Docker, so I really had to do it. Beyond that, more pragmatic reasons in the case of this client was, you know, Docker, I won't cover the basics of Docker. I don't mean to cover the basics. I assume you all know what Docker is about. Docker itself is a container engine. You give it a container, it runs it, and it's cool. And then Docker is responsible for talking to LXC, setting up the namespaces, isolating your processes and all that. And that's pretty cool in itself. For us, that was not the main value. One of the main values for us was the way Docker really simplified application packaging deployment and execution. So I have a container, I have my Tomcat container, I know it has the right version of Java in it, I know it has the right version of Tomcat in it, I know it has the right version of the userland tools, scripts, libraries that I need. It's there, I know they're there because I put them there, so I don't depend on anyone to do the installations in some other servers. The container has all it needs, and for me that's enough, because I know that when I move containers across my servers, whatever was here is the same that I have there, is the same that I have in every other server. So the containers really are, for us, really great means for simplifying the packaging. A container contains all that I needed to have, the right versions at the right place, and I know it's there and I don't need to worry about it. So for us, it made a huge difference in terms of packaging and deployment. Another advantage is that, again, this client is very tight when it comes to infrastructure. Cloud is like so far ahead that it's not even funny anymore. So what we get is that, you know, we put in a request, we work with a server, it takes 2 weeks, it comes back, gets the server. That server will remain there for as long as it has to be there. Which means that all these ideas of let's bring a server, use it for a couple of days, throw it away because we screw it up, and then bring up another one, it's actually not possible. We're using Docker for kind of what I'm saying here, flexibly provision components on top of servers. The idea is that I get a container, I drop it in a server, it's isolated in a container, it runs, when I'm done, I throw it away, and then I move on. Right? So for us really it made a difference in the sense that still working on very, very, very static infrastructure, very static hosts, as long as we have capacity available, we can easily take a container, put it whatever we like, run it for as long as we have to, and then that's it really. We don't have to depend on the client taking a week, 2 weeks, just to really give us a new server. So it's made a huge difference for us and for our project. It's also helped us with the improving research utilization of this infrastructure. Because many times we have servers, we call it the development server, the test server, whatever, they're underutilized. So we dedicate a server just for something that runs not very often, but it runs maybe for 2 weeks for some client demos or client acceptance tests, whatever, and then outside of that time frame, nothing happens there. With Docker, actually, we have been able to provision some of our components on the same server in a way that increase utilization. We can still run multiple versions of our containers, multiple copies of it on the same host by simply deploying them as long as we have capacity free in that server. So we have really managed to achieve better resource utilization because containers for us are a much more general way of deploying than VMs, for example. Right? Something for developers as well. I mentioned containers, they really have everything they have to run. A container has all the components in it. Anyone can actually pull a container from our registry into the workstation, and they can be sure it's the same container we have running in any of our other servers. Production, non-production, development, it doesn't matter. It's always going to be the same container, no changes. There's no installation routes anyone has to follow. There's no Puppet scripts anyone has to follow. Docker pool, my services version, whatever, I have it running locally, right? That's actually very useful for developers because they can actually on Heavy Loader, we make a new container every time we run our pipeline, Jenkins. So essentially, every single commit has a container, it has a version number. Any developer can go and just pull the right version from a specific pipeline, they get that specific container, they can run it without no more effort than a single Docker command on the workstation. And it's not just on our local workstations. Essentially, any server can be turned into a application server in no time by just pulling the containers. We use this a lot, for example, for provisioning environment for demos for the clients. You know, they come up, you know, we need an environment for 2 days to give a demo to client. Okay, then no problem. We just get containers, find some capacity on the servers. We run them without the need to really having to actually request specific new capacity for these for the servers. A bit about our container principles, so kind of our commandments or ground rules that we set that we had in place in order to ensure we build containers in a consistent manner. You may know some of these, but anyway, I think they're important. One thing is that our containers usually, or 99% of the cases, they run a single logical service per container. Not a single process, that's not always the case, but a single logical service. So sometimes we have to run more than one process within the same container if they're all part of the same logical service, logical process, but that's okay. But still, from a principal perspective, we try to run smaller containers because we find them better to actually reason about. So smaller containers, they're easy to allocate, they're easy to run, as opposed to huge containers running multiple processes. They're very heavy, they take more resources, so for us it's a lot more flexible. We talked about this, containers, we handle containers as cattle, not pets. I don't know if you know the example, it was covered in one of the DevOps sessions before. You know, you have a pet, and the pet gets sick, you caress the pet, you take it to the vet, you cure it. If cattle get sick, you shoot it, okay? I'm a big proponent of immutable infrastructure. Essentially, when a container is so screwed that you can't fix it, you just don't bother, throw it away, provision a new one. You can be certain it'll be the same one you just shot, because, you know, they all came from the same source. So for us, really, we don't spend too much time trying to fix containers. In fact, we didn't even try. We tried to keep containers stateless. We don't change them, okay? So that's why we really handle them as cattle. Something goes wrong, whatever. Just stop it, bring a new one. You know it's the same, so let's get going. We try not to run SSH in containers. Actually, if I catch anyone running SSH in containers, I'm going to come and shoot you as cattle. You shouldn't do that anymore. So if you need to access your containers with SSH, you're probably doing it wrong. But if you really, really have to, then just use Docker exec. It will let you access a running container from the host, and that's a more secure way. State in containers is actually a pretty interesting matter. Because I said we try to keep containers stateless and immutable. That's not always possible. In the real world, many applications will need to persist state to container. That's fine if they really have to. We typically try to find ways around it. I don't know if you heard about data volumes and data-only containers, but those are ways that Docker lets you have containers persisting some of the data to an outside container or to an outside data volume. We actually don't like those too much. We try to, if we have to persist any data, we'll persist it to the host. And the reasoning is, you know, if I'm going to bind my container to some data, then I'm just going to bind to the host. The problem with things like data volumes is that they're very opaque. I can't peek inside a data volume unless I run it with a container. The problem with data-only containers is very much the same. I can't look inside of it unless it runs. So, you know, why really couple my containers to data volume? Because when the containers are running, I can't see what's inside. So we just couple them to the host if we really have to. We don't do environment-specific containers. So containers should not be aware of where they're running. And that's why I can have a container running here, which I have, or I can have a container running in any other one of my servers. They should not be aware of where they run. They should be totally independent of the environment where they have to run. And I'm gonna leave it here because later we'll see a bit more about how we configure containers, because at the end of the day, you will have to have containers aware of when they run, or at least the applications in them. But as a general practice, containers are absolutely independent. We try not to make assumptions about where a container will run in our Docker files. And then container networking, it's a very interesting topic. You can get very fancy with this. There are tools like Flannel, tools like Weave. I'm not going to talk about them. Those are tools that let you build private networks, software-defined networks on top of your existing physical networks, so you can get Docker containers to have each run their own IP address. They're actually really, really interesting tools, but also really complex. For the type of application that we've built, where we have Tomcat, Nginx, and Postgres, each one of them running on a specific port that you know in advance, for us, we didn't see the need to make it so complicated. Forwarding ports from the host has been more than sufficient for our inter-container network communication, and also from outside the container. So that's been sufficient. How did we do that? So these were our principles. Then let me show you as well how we actually managed to build and operate with our containers. First of all, we have what we call a container hierarchy. What we run are the containers at the bottom. So the service container has Tomcat and some Java services, front-end database, and some other infrastructure services. Those are the ones that we run. At the top, we have the so-called the hierarchy. These are kind of intermediate containers. We have at the top, we actually based our container on CentOS, so we have a full operating system inside our container. Then we have a base container that has our common settings for each and every one container that we run, like some common users and specific packages and so on. And then we have much more specific containers which are specialized for specific things. And then at the bottom, we have the ones that we run. The reason for these container hierarchies is to kind of segregate the functionality of different containers in a way that they are smaller and more specifically doing one thing and doing it well. We could have one big container with everything, and then we prefer to keep containers small. Another reason is to keep the build times smaller. So for example, I mentioned, and I'll show you later, every time someone does a push to Git, we have a pipeline, the pipeline builds a container. So it's obviously faster to just take a container with Tomcat, JVM, and everything, all of that installed, and just dump the word in it, than every time trying to build the whole container from scratch. So we do use container hierarchies, and they've been quite effective for us to really minimize the build times. Container hierarchies have some limitations, but I'm going to show that later. How do we build containers? Docker containers uploaded the Docker file, and Docker file is just a collection of kind of commands or statements that tells Docker what to do to build the container. Docker files are good. In our case, we still use Puppet. The reason, and Puppet probably is not the best choice. The reason is we had a prior investment in Puppet automation. We had a pretty big library of Puppet manifests, Puppet modules, that we wanted to keep using. So when we started to use Docker, we thought that it could be a good idea to, let's not just throw away all our existing automation, let's try to take some of our Puppet stuff and bring it in Docker. The good news is it runs perfectly well. Docker doesn't care what you use inside your Docker file, so what you see at the bottom is an example of a Docker file where we simply install our Puppet automation RPM, and then we just run Docker, and this works perfect. The problem is that then, before I can run Puppet, I need to install Puppet in the container, which makes them slightly more bloated than if I didn't have to use Puppet. I think it's about 100 megs, because we need to install the Ruby runtime, the Puppet runtime, a bunch of gems, and so on, so on. The containers actually get quite big very soon. We are actually planning to migrate away from Puppet eventually. Docker files really gives you everything you need to build a container. There shouldn't be any need to to run Puppet or Swift or whatever you prefer to build your containers. With the advantage being that your containers will always be smaller than if you don't have to install any of these at build time. Besides, you need Puppet, right? Puppet is used for getting running systems back into some sort of baseline or compliance. As I said, we don't run Puppet in running containers anymore. We only use once at build time. And in this case, it works, but again, the best idea or my suggestion for you guys would be trying to avoid using tools like Puppet or Chef just because you're familiar with them. Dockerfile should be more than sufficient. I talked about how we build our containers. So we build them automatically, really. We don't do anything manual anymore. Jenkins is a pretty good tool for this. We have a build pipeline. Every single time someone pushes a change on our Java repo, every time someone pushes a change to our front-end repo, pipeline, build a container, and off you go. I think we have like 600-700 of containers by now, because you know we build like 3 or 4 every day, so we have tons of them. It doesn't really take so much space. You know, first of all, storage is cheap, and second, because you know Docker uses layers, right? So usually, taking our base image and then adding a couple of word files on top, it's just another layer. So 80% of the container, 90% of the container is actually shared with the previous ones. So making multiple builds on a daily basis is not a problem in terms of wasting space. It's actually really, really fast. And the advantage is for us, again, anyone can go to registry, look up, you know, which version that they need, which version they need of a specific container, pull it, run it, that's it. It really simplifies things a lot. There's a plugin for Jenkins to build containers. I think it's Docker build step. We used it. It had some edge cases where it didn't work. So eventually we switched to using shell. But there really is no problem at all running Docker commands on Jenkins, and it works really well. We test containers. Everyone likes to test, right? I'm sure you guys test a lot. We also test them. The process itself is a bit convoluted. There was no good solution so far for us to do unit testing of containers. So essentially, what we're trying to answer here is, once I build the container, how can I make sure it actually has what it's supposed to have? There's a really good tool called Service Spec. I don't know if you know it, Service Spec. It lets you write kind of BBB style assertions on infrastructure. So you have to check things like, make sure I have, check that I have this package version installed, make sure this port is open, make sure this service is running. It's really good. We also use it to run or to test our own containers. The process itself is a bit complicated because we have a container that we call the container under test. We have a container that extends it, installs Ruby, service spec, injects our tests, and then essentially we run the tests within the test container. You can see the code in there, but I'm not sure if it's going to make too much sense if you've not used service spec before. It also is a bit complicated because for RHEL or for CentOS or Red Hat Enterprise Linux, getting a decent version of Ruby is a pain in the ass. You have to actually install the server collection library and all sorts of weird shit that would be easier in other operating systems. But anyway, we want to test something like Nginx. We install, you know, Ruby, and then we just run service spec tests. And with this, we actually can ensure that we test our containers, and then we have specific test cases for each that actually make sure we have whatever we should be having in there. Okay, so where do we store containers? We're big fans of Artifactory, so for us it's kind of an Uber repo, because we store everything in Artifactory. PMs, we store JavaScript packages, we store the Java artifacts, and we store containers. So for us, it was a very good solution. However, now, as of Docker 1.6, there's a new registry format, a new registry API, which Docker released as a registry 2.0. And obviously, Artifactory isn't ready yet. So we also have a registry 2.0 running as a container for us to dump our containers in there. The registry itself is a container, so it's actually trivial to go running. No problem with that. In Artifactory, you can hit Artifactory Pro, so the paid version, in order to run the containers on your hosts. And then, how do we run the containers? I mentioned drunkens, bears and party entertainers. They go to a registry. We, I don't know if you guys have heard of Randbook before. It's a really good tool for automating tasks, kind of having runbooks that define operations that need to happen, and then you can say, please run this book on all these many hosts to do these operations. So we actually have Randbook deploy containers to our host automatically from a very nice user interface. I totally recommend Randbook as a tool for automating operations processes. Really have a look because it's pretty good. And then we essentially have Randbook automating the process of deploying containers. This line here is a dotted line, so because we haven't got to this one yet, but eventually through Jenkins we'll be also able to automate the deployment of containers to any host through Randbook. And it works really well. It's a great tool. I mentioned that sometimes we run more than one process in a container, but Docker itself only monitors a single process within a container, right? The kind of the entry point of the container. We need the process manager sometimes. There's two good ones here in Landry. One of them is Runit. We heard about it. The other one is Supervisor. We do Supervisor in cases we need, and this is a real example where, you know, we need to run a web server and we're going to run a very simple script to doing errors every few minutes of some internal packages. And Supervisor works well, and it's something that I would definitely recommend you guys look at if you need to run more than one process per container. How do we configure containers? We actually do it in two ways. So for simple things, there's a tool called Confd, where it lets you inject environment variables into some template files. Right? So you pass the environment variable here, you tell your Nginx config file, your backend server is this one, and then this magically ends up in your Nginx configuration file, and that's it. With this, we can actually, from the Docker run command line, we can actually automate the process of injecting configuration at containers, so that again, this container does not need to know where it's going to run. I just make it know that when I run it. Okay, that's the simple case. There's a more complex case where we work with Java applications. That means bazillions of property files all over the place. So in those cases, it's not really convenient to have, I don't know, 35, 40 different environment variables that I actually inject into templates. So what we do is that we also, you know, this parameter here in the Docker run, that actually lets me inject a local folder into a container folder transparently. So some of our hosts have configuration specifically for that host, like database JDBC URLs, like also for the configuration, but actually we can easily inject into the container by simply providing the /v property. So that's how we actually configure our containers at runtime. And again, the container itself has some basic configuration. If I pull this container and I do not do any of this, it will run, but it will not know exactly where its JDBC database or what its database is and so on and where to find it. So we need to inject the configuration. Security is very important for our client, obviously. I'm not going to go too deep into security just very quickly because Docker recently released a document that is actually really good in terms of explaining what you should do to secure Docker, to tighten it. So I'm going to show it to you later. The basic things we have applied is that, you know, Docker has a daemon, and the daemon runs as root. And unless you tell Docker, my container uses this other user, your container will run also as root. That's a problem sometimes, most of the times, actually always. That's not a good practice. So what we do is that we use the user thing in the Docker file. And then, you know, you say user, some container user, and then when the container boots or starts, Docker will automatically change to a least privileged user, you know, depending on how you set it up. So this would be one of my strongest recommendations for you as well, that make sure your containers can run unprivileged all the time to increase security. This is also, in terms of security, this is a pretty funny problem. when you have a container hierarchy, remember there was the there's been several OpenSSL security bugs, right? And you know, it's at the right above your hierarchy. Hey, what happens to my auto containers? Shit, they all need to be updated ASAP, right? So the problem with container hierarchies, and I'm gonna get back to this later as well, is that you know, a change at the very top means I have to actually change and redeploy every single one of my freaking containers underneath. One thing you should make sure you have when you go to Docker is proper automation for handling all these deployments, because it's not going to work without it. Because of this, really. You need to be always keeping these things up to date with security updates, patches, whatever. Otherwise, you run the risk of compromising each and every one of these things. And as you remember, we do not do updates to running containers. We don't update packages in running containers. We always rebuild and redeploy. That's kind of a consequence of doing it that way, that you know, we need to then rebuild and redeploy each and every single one of these containers. But that's something to keep in mind with security. SE Linux, I have to admit, I don't know much about SE Linux. I do understand why it's used. Do you guys know about SE Linux? So kind of providing very much increased security capabilities to the Linux kernel. You have much more granular controls as to what pieces can do. You can assign them labels, roles, levels. It's fairly complex. Docker can work with that. It can, but you will mess up eventually, and then weird things start to happen. I'm going to leave it here. SE Linux is a topic that we could be talking about for days because it's very complicated. But whenever you think of going Docker, look at your SE Linux settings in your host and see whether you really have to run SE Linux or not. And if not, my advice to keep your sanity is that you switch it off unless there's a really strong reason to keep it on. How do we operate these containers? So, container state, one of the things, I mentioned this before, so in an ideal world, containers don't have state. Good, that's the easy case. But then reality hits you and it's like, well, yeah, containers will always have to keep state. There's no way around it. Things like log files, we'll get to that in a second. Things like, you know, small configuration files, temporary files, whatever, that all goes to the container. Our experience is that don't keep it in the container if you can avoid it. If you cannot avoid it, our experience has been that it's best to write to the host. So, you know, you can get a folder from the host visible in the container. Make sure you can write that data into the host. And that's been sufficient for us. Of course, then problems come with things like logging. One thing you should absolutely not do is keep logs within the container, because by mistake you could delete the container, you could lose the logs. So you probably want to have some sort of way to write into the host, which you do, and then perhaps use a log aggregator. That's worked well in some scenarios. And then as of Docker 1.6, actually you can write, Docker, the daemon, can actually write the container logs into syslog. So it actually makes things a lot easier, because then you can pipe to syslog into something like logstash, if that's what you're running, or whatever, Splunk, or whatever other aggregator you may be working with. So logging has finally been properly addressed in Docker, but that only happened like a month ago or so. In terms of monitoring, you know, we don't run monitoring agents or anything like that within our containers. A container in itself, you know, a process that runs in a container, it's just like any other process in the operating system. It has a PID, it has some resources, you can connect to it if it has a port and so on. So we haven't really done anything differently to monitor containers or processes within containers or working with Docker. They're just like any other tool. If you like Zabbix, Nachos, whatever, use it and it's going to work just fine with your containers. So easy, at least so far for us. Okay, but Docker, not everything is peachy in Docker. It has a darker side. I mentioned this before, right? Immutable containers are fun until there's an emergency security update, and then you have 10 intermediate containers, and then you have 30 containers you run, and each one of those needs the goddamn update, and it needs it now. So My recommendation would be invest in deployment automation for the Docker containers, because you will need it, right? We're doing a lot of this containerization so that we can avoid a lot of manual work and deploying and installing packages. It doesn't make sense that then we end up spending this amount of time manually deploying fixed containers. So try to invest in automating all these container build and rollout processes, because you will need it. Especially another minimizing approach, or to minimize the problem, could be to have containers where you don't run a full operating system. We run CentOS, which means we have a ton of packages in there. Many of them we don't need. You could try to run smaller CentOS. You could try to run no OS at all. That's possible. But so far, for example, if you want to containerize Jovian apps, we haven't found another way to run some sort of OS within the container. There was no way we could run without. Docker is 2 years old. It just turned 2, I think, last month. There's a lot of work to do in Docker. The things that are there now, they will work. They have been working fine for us for almost a year by now. But it still is a work in progress. There is still a lot of work we need to do. There is a new fixed logging. They're now working on fixing networking. For example, you need a third-party product to get containers to talk to each other over a private network. They're working on addressing that. They're working on storage drivers. They're working on all sorts of things that are not there. At the moment, you can't even cryptographically sign a container. You can't do it for your private containers, and that's something that would be very important for us. They're working on it, but again, there's no telling when some of this stuff will be in place. So be aware that Docker is changing. I mentioned before there's a new container registry that came with a new container API. Registry API. That API is much faster, and it's good. The problem is it's only much faster if you're working with Docker client 1.6. If you don't, then you can't. If you want to deploy that new registry, you need to be aware it only works with it only works with 1.6 or newer clients. If you have older clients, like 1.5 and newer, it's not going to work, so you don't need 2 registries. It's maddening. So just for you to be aware that Docker will change, Docker will keep changing, things will evolve. Some things for which now we have to have custom scripts and infrastructure, glue and whatever, those things will eventually go away as Docker evolves, but still this will remain, I think, for the foreseeable future, a work in progress. I talked about Synodes before, and that's just a warning. I'm not trying to be ominous or anything, but sooner or later we will be beaten by a real interaction between Docker, kernel, PAM, Linux, and a container, and that's going to stick up your ass for like days until we fix it. We currently are facing one of these problems. Some containers were just, they're doing some really weird stuff in the host. We don't know what it is. I went through Red Hat's Bugzilla, I went through Docker's, GitHub issues. I can't find a solution, but I learned a lot about previous problems, and it's not fun. Especially, there was a specific one where someone changed like 2 lines of code in the kernel or the subsystem, whatever. Well, that broke Docker 1.1 until someone figured it out, right? So, we are at such a low level with Docker that, you know, these interactions between components, security, Linux, kernel, there are problems there from time to time, and one of those times will affect you, so, you know, don't despair, use the support channels and see if you can fix the problem. That's a funny thing. You can pack containers, you can give them a label. So for example, you know, if you want to pull CentOS 6, you do this, so Docker pull CentOS 6, you get it. The problem is, anyone can override the label. So CentOS 6 yesterday may be different from CentOS 6 today from the Docker registry. And you have no way to tell if it changes at all. You just don't know, right? So at the moment, there's an option of pinning versions or being more specific in the registry, unless the person's publishing the containers take the effort of putting snapshots or dates as the version numbers or something. So our recommendation is that you somehow keep local copies of your containers and your own registry, and you tap them appropriately so that you know which version you need to use at which time. Otherwise, you know, people like Santos, people like Ubuntu, they really are not tagging their things properly. Security, if you're interested in Docker security, there's this really, really good document, it came out like 2 weeks ago, have a look. Docker security needs attention. The defaults are usually pretty good, but again, if you're running this SE Linux or Paramore, make sure you check this document and give you some good guidelines as to what you should do to secure things like the Docker daemon, Docker sockets, Docker files. Please have a look at this. Our lessons learned very quickly. We think Docker as a container engine is ready for production workload. I would have no problems recommending each and every one of you to go and try and run your things in Docker these days on production, because we really think it's ready. It's been working well for us, and I don't see why it shouldn't work just as well for you. Docker, for us, much more than the container thing, much more than being a container engine, it's worked really well for us in terms of packaging. Why? Because the whole container is what you need and nothing else. Whatever you need is in the container, you can be sure that as you move across environments, what is in the container is what you really want to have. For us, in our experience, pushing for containerizing everything has had more flexibility. It's really given us the flexibility to use resources better and understand from the beginning. However, be pragmatic. Still, do not just rush and start putting everything in Docker containers just because it's cool. You saw in the beginning, we're not running Postgres in the container, and the reason was that Postgres is very much IO heavy. There are some concerns with IO performance of containers, so we actually decided not to containerize Postgres because we weren't sure it would actually be a good idea. So that's where we were a bit pragmatic, you know. Postgres, we will not containerize, and we just keep it outside. We have kept it outside of a containers. Docker files are all you could possibly need to build containers, and that's good. And then, you know, start small. I guess that's pretty basic advice, but putting anything in containers will take time until we figure things out, how we do builds, how we do maintenance, how we operate them, how we deploy them, how we lock, handle the logs and all that. It will take some time till we get there, so start small, take one of your small containers, see if you can work with it and make it run, and then from there, organically try to build a bigger Docker platform on top. Okay, that's it.
Any questions?
First one.
So from that perspective, what's the benefits, what are the benefits of container compared to virtualization? I mean, cloud or private cloud? You mentioned that you didn't have that option, that there were physical servers and not very flexible infrastructure, but if you have a choice of doing virtualization versus container, what are the benefits?
For us, it's been about the granularity. So a container is much more easy to shovel on a host than a VM. So we can take, in the same capacity that you run 3 VMs, you could run 30 containers because they use a lot less resources. For example, they share the same kernel, so we don't have to allocate specific memory to specific VMs. A container runs on the host, it uses whatever kernel, it shares the memory, it shares buffers, it shares caches with all the other processes in the host. So I would still go for both anyway. I would use VMs to partition the physical resources, and then containers on top as the means to better and be more granular about allocating my resources.
Yeah, there was one. Two small questions. You mentioned that you're happy that you can move containers across different servers. Can you share if there are some business cases where these different servers are other than traditional development, local, staging, pre-life, and live? And second, like, I'm not a developer, so just wondering if I understood correctly that you have like mission-specific containers within one project on one, let's say, on one server instance or within one virtual machine. But what is the protocol of, say, data exchange or request between different containers?
Okay, say, if I start with the second, because I forgot the first already. Well, you say our case, it's very simple. It's all HTTP all the way, really. What was that?
Do they have their IP or like HTTP to what? To a URL with a certain module after it, or?
Yeah, so as you can see, for example, the communication between the Nginx containers and or the communication between the Tomcat containers and the underlying components, it's Postgres or JDBC. We don't assign specific IP addresses for a container. They log on a host and then they use port forwarding to communicate, to let them talk to each other when they have to. What I meant is that I can take a container and the same container that I deploy to development, I can then next deploy to test, I can deploy to acceptance, and I can deploy to production while being sure that it's been always the same container all the time.
And if you don't mind, there is one more use case when you have like a slower machine and you need to move your container to the more performant machine. So you just buy new hardware and move a couple of containers that you need more performance to a different machine. I have a couple of questions. The first question that you said, the first you described that you're not using data volumes a lot. And I
said, not at all, actually.
Yeah. I've seen a lot of presentations saying that this is a Docker way and you have to run a container for one service and so on, and I was trying to follow like this approach and actually I failed. why you specifically don't use the data volumes? Because it's hard, or it's hard to manage?
They're hard to manage because right now you can take a container, you push to a registry, and it's there. There's no registry for data volumes. And second, you can't look into a data volume unless it's mounted to a container.
Yes.
And for things like backups, that was pretty annoying.
This was like the Docker guy said that if you need to backup like data volume, you run additional container, link them together, and do whatever you need, and then drop the container what was doing the work.
You could do that. Yes, I didn't really agree.
Okay. Another thing is like from this chart, I assume that Nginx for you it's load balancer.
Yes.
Okay.
And
the question was related to how you do the zero downtime deployments. So are you doing them by hand, like dropping the two, updating them, and then dropping another two, or something like that?
We don't have to do that. We don't need zero runtime deployments. But if we had to, we would do it like that, and manually as well, yes.